Okay, let's get started. Ladies and gentlemen, good evening or late afternoon. Welcome. Tonight we will be talking about the Palestine-Israel conflict. In the last 20 years or so, most people who were speaking about that conflict were using the peace, the Oslo peace framework. At the core of this framework, there is a for land for peace formula. At least, ideally speaking, and from the point of view of the Palestinian side, at the end of the peace process, there should be two states between the sea and the river. Palestine next to Israel, on the occupied, on the territories which were occupied in the 1967 war. But as we know, the peace process collapsed in the summer 2000. Since that time, there have been several failed attempts at reviving the peace process. So that's no wonder that many people begin to speak about an alternative solution. Instead of having two states between the sea and the river, what about one state between the sea and the river? And this is not a new idea. In the 20s of the last century, the Zionist group Brit Shalom proposed one state for Arabs and Jews, a bi-national state, as they called it. In this place, we are in Prague. I think it's important to recall that some of the most vocal members of that group were born in this city and spent significant part, the first part of their life in this city. For instance, Robert Welch, Hans Kohn, Hugo Berman. Hugo Berman was the salient figure of that group. And already in 1911, he wrote an article entitled Notes on the Arab Question after his visit of Palestine. And in the article, he criticized strongly the colonialist tendencies of the Zionist movement. He, for instance, noticed that some Jews behave towards Arabs, as he said, Europeans behave to blacks, and he deeply disliked that. So that was for that reason, I think, to counter those colonialist tendencies that he endorsed one state solution in the 20s and joined the group Brit Shalom. Nevertheless, as we know, this position was marginalized in the 30s and 40s within the Zionist movement. But one state solution reemerged 40 years after on the other side of the national or nationalist divide, if you like, when the movement Fatah at the turn of the 60s and 70s called for one state between the sea and the river. In this time, one state which would be secular, democratic, and which would ensure equality among all the citizens, regardless of their religious affiliation, be them Jews, Muslims, or Christians. Now, I think one of the interesting questions tonight will be to what extent the present one-state solution is resembling more the Brit Shalom idea or the civic state idea of the former Fatah movement. And to enlighten us about this issue and many other issues, we have with us tonight our distinguished guest, Professor Ilan Pappe, who was born in Haifa. He got his PhD at Oxford University. He taught at Haifa University, at first at the history department, then in the Department of Political Science. And then in 2006, he moved to Great Britain, to Exeter University, where he's a director of the European Center for Palestine Studies, and a co-director of the Exeter Center for Ethnopolitical Studies. I will mention only two or three books he has published, The Ethnic Cleansing of Palestine, 2007, A History of Modern Palestine, One Land, Two Peoples, 2003, and The Modern Middle East, second edition published 2012. So I will give him now 45 minutes. So that he makes his case for one state solution, and then we will have half an hour of questions and debate.
Excellent.
Ilan, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Thank you. First of all, I want to apologize for the delay, and I hope you didn't mind waiting. But I'm glad I'm here, so I won't waste time explaining why we're late. It's an interesting story, but it's not directly connected to one state, so I will dispense with that one. I'm an historian, and I'm an academic, and I'm very much aware of my role as an individual when I talk about solutions. I think we have to be modest as individuals. We cannot believe that we have a solution and all the rest of the people do not have a solution, or that we have worked out a solution to such details that we know exactly how tomorrow to go about it. I think the role of intellectuals, of people who are academics and scholars, is to widen the scope of the debate rather than to make dramatic statements or sound bites, what they support or they don't support, because they are not better than anyone else in either predicting the future or in having great ideas about how to solve complex situations as we have on the ground on Israel and Palestine. But because I'm an historian and I'm particularly interested in the history of the Zionist movement and the Zionist ideology and the Zionist strategy, because that's my particular interest, more than anything else, although I've written on the Palestinian national movement, on Palestinian history, but my main interest is to understand the place I come from, because I was born in Israel and I was part of that system. Because of my reading of Zionist history, my first conclusion is that as far as the Zionist movement is concerned, or as far as most of the political forces in Israel today are concerned, but that is also true about the past, there will never be a two-state solution. So it's not, for me, it's not just a matter of whether I like the idea of one state and I prefer it to two states. I will get to this as well. I don't want to evade my own opinion on this. But my main point is that the Zionist movement, in the center of the Zionist movement, the strategy was always to have as much of Palestine as possible with as few Palestinians in it as possible. Now, when at a certain stage the Zionist movement invented the idea of the two-state solution, it wanted to create the impression that it does not want the whole of Palestine and does not mind if in small part of Palestine some Palestinians remain. And in that particular small part, if they want to call it a state, at least mainstream Zionism said, we can tolerate it. So what I will share with you this afternoon and early evening is the history that brings me to such a conclusion. And I will end by saying, how do I think we can proceed from here? Which is less important, I think, because, as I said, I'm not a political leader, I'm not a prime minister, and I don't have a political party. I just have my own views. The Zionist movement began not far away from here, in the late 19th century, and was motivated by two impulses, which were quite understandable, and I think in many ways even respectable. One was a sense of certain Jews that Europe was not secure, They felt that anti-Semitism could be worse, could be institutionalized. I wouldn't say that they prophesized the Holocaust, but they felt that the ground was burning in many ways, and they needed to move ahead, or move away, rather. The second impulse, which began even earlier than Zionism, but Zionism captured that impulse, was the wish, like so many other religious groups and nations around Europe in the mid-19th century, to reinvent yourself as a national movement. You were feeling that your religious identity did not really fit the way you lived, because more and more Jews ceased to be religious. So they asked themselves, what does it mean to be a Jew? And this idea to reinvent Judaism as a national movement fitted well with the first impulse. I'm not secure here, and I'm a nation, so I need a homeland. And as you probably know, they were looking for several options, not Palestine alone, right? I mean, the most famous one was Uganda in Africa, but they were looking for Argentina, Azerbaijan, even a very nice, that's the one I liked, I'm sorry they didn't take it. There was a very nice island north of Buffalo in the United States, near the Niagara Falls. Nobody lived there, they would not have to dispossess anyone. It would have been wonderful if Israel was there. A bit cold, I must admit, but otherwise quite pleasant. But they did choose Palestine, also for reasonable motives. The connection of the Jewish people to the land of Israel is obvious. The Bible was an important book. So it was not surprising that Palestine was one of the places that they had in mind. It is also not surprising that the fact that someone else was living in Palestine did not bother them, because Zionism appeared in the end of the colonialist period. And colonialist movements did not really bother much about the fact who lived in areas they wanted to colonize, right? Think about Latin America, think about North America, think about Australia, Africa, Algeria. It never stopped colonization, the fact that someone else was there. And I think Zionism was a bit different and was much more like the white settlers who came to Australia and North America, because they did not only want to colonize in the name of a mother country, they wanted to colonize and reinvent themselves as a new nation. So they were, I don't buy this myth that says that the Zionists did not know that there were Palestinians in Palestine. They knew. They knew that there were Palestinians in Palestine. But what they said is that their project of recreating a Jewish people again on the ancient land of Israel was far more modern, far more progressive, far more important than the aspirations of the local people. And those of them who were really modernizationists said it would even benefit the local people if we succeed. It would be for their own benefit. This was the early Zionist. The problem started when, just before the First World War, a group of people came from Eastern Europe, more than Central Europe, with different ideas about the native people. And this group, which we call in Israel the second wave of immigration, Aliyah Shniyah, is like the Mayflower of Zionism. You know, it's the core group from which the state of Israel really sprang. And that core group did have a different idea. When you read their diaries, when you read their journals, when you read their letters, you see that they looked at the Palestinians as foreigners who took over something that does not belong to them. They were not just a nuisance for being there. They were aggressive people who took over something that belonged to the Zionists. And this particular group, from very early on, was determined that if you wanted to succeed in creating a Jewish state in Palestine, you have to get rid of the Palestinians. Now, they couldn't do it in 1914. They were 10% of the population. They were very poor. They had no military force. The Ottoman Empire was not very supportive of the Zionist project. It changed when the British took over after the First World War. The British Empire, through the Balfour Declaration, said we recognize the right of the Jews for a national homeland in Palestine. Although one should say the British did not think that that should have involved the expulsion of the Palestinians. But they did allow the Zionist movement to build the military power that prepared them for the moment, for the opportunity that came in 1948 to implement this dream of making Palestine a Jewish space or a Jewish place. And when the British decided to leave, the Zionist leadership decided that it had a rare historical opportunity. I think they wanted to expel everyone, and they did quite a good job, one can talk about it this way, within the space that became the Jewish state, which is 80% of historical Palestine, that is Israel today, without the West Bank and the Gaza Strip, lived 1 million, point one maybe, Palestinians. Almost 800,000 out of that million were expelled. So within 80% of Palestine, they created a Jewish state which was almost empty from the native people who lived there before the Palestinians. They did not occupy the West Bank. They did not occupy the Gaza Strip. As you probably remember, the West Bank went to Jordan. The Gaza Strip went to Egypt. But in the rest of the land of Palestine, the Jewish state took over. But they did not expel everyone, as you know. This is why we have today what we call in Israel the Arab minority in Israel, or as they call themselves, the Palestinian minority, or as the Palestinians call them, the Arabs of 1948. Call them what you call them, they are there. And they are today 20% of the population. Now, in many ways, historically, you would have said that there were three state solutions before June 67. Jordan was occupying the West Bank, or annexing the West Bank. Egypt had a military rule over the Gaza Strip, and the rest was the State of Israel. So you had Palestine divided into three, I don't know, states, but three sections, right? Now, 1967 provided a new opportunity for Israel. I won't go, that's a different lecture, why the war of 1967 erupted. I have my own ideas about it, but that's another lecture. But at least we can all agree, whatever we think of why the war started, we can agree that after 6 days of fighting, Israel occupied the West Bank and the Gaza Strip. At least this is not a contentious historical fact, right? Israel became Greater Israel after the war. So after kicking out almost 1 million Palestinians in 1948, Israel suddenly takes in another 1.5 million Palestinians. And that's a big problem. If you worked so hard to make sure that you have as much of the land as possible with as few Palestinians in it as possible, what do you do in 67? Where you have the whole of the land, which is good from a Zionist perspective, but you lose the demographic majority that you had. And I think this is when the current two-state solution was born, not the old one. The old one belongs to the United Nations in 1947, when it tries to offer what it sees like a reasonable idea. Half of Palestine would go to the Jews, half of Palestine would go to the Palestinians. I'm not going into it, it's another lecture, what happened in the partition resolution. I can't cover everything in 35 minutes. But it doesn't matter. I don't think there's any relevance to the 47 partition resolution. 67 brings birth, if you want, to a new idea of a two-state solution that is born in the Israeli left, if one can call it, the Israeli Zionist left. But I don't think it was really about two states. It was about how to, I don't know if there's such an expression in Czech, because you have such good cakes. Probably this is not a good expression in Czech, but in English you say you cannot have the cake and eat it, right? Or I may probably got it wrong also in English. Never mind. But you can't have both. There you are. Exactly. Exactly. I couldn't have put it better. You're absolutely right. And I think the problem was that you had the land that you wanted, but you didn't have the people in the land that you wanted, right? And what the Israeli government decided in 1967 is very relevant to the idea of one state or two states. They could not do in 67 what they did in 1948. In 67, they could not expel the people of the West Bank and the Gaza Strip as they did in 1948. So they had to accept that the people in the West Bank, quite a lot of them, and even more so in the Gaza Strip, were refugees from 1948, would now stay where they are. So the solution they used in 1948 was not relevant for 67. Okay. So there was one problem was solved. We are not going to expel the Palestinians, although I know some of you would say, those of you who know the history well, that quite a few Palestinians were expelled after 67, that is true, but it was not the massive expulsion of 1948. The vast majority of people who lived in the West Bank and the Gaza Strip were not removed. The second question was, do we give the territories back to Jordan or Egypt? That was another option. So you don't have to even bother with the question, do we expel or we don't expel? And the Israeli government in 1967 said, no way. For all kinds of reasons, we will never give up the West Bank. I don't want to offend anyone from Gaza, but even at that time, they were not sure they wanted the Gaza Strip. The Egyptians didn't want the Gaza Strip. The Israelis didn't want the Gaza Strip. Gaza Strip was a problem for them. But the West Bank, they knew that they wanted to be part of Israel for religious reasons, because they really believed, or national reasons, not even religious, national reasons. They really believed that the heart of ancient Israel was not in Israel, it was in the West Bank. The cities which are mentioned in the Bible, the whole narrative of who the Hebrew people are, geographically takes place in the West Bank, not in what Israel was before 67. But there was also strategic consideration. You probably are familiar. Abba Ibn, who was the diplomat number one of Israel, used to say, to call the borders of the West Bank the Auschwitz borders, sort of indicating that if Israel goes back to the 67 borders, it would be in a danger of annihilation. And they developed this bizarre idea that the Jordan River is a natural barrier that would stop attacks of Israel. Now, I don't know if you've seen the Jordan River. Even if you are 95 years old and you don't walk that much, you can cross the river with one jump. To think that the River Jordan is a natural barrier, you have to have the imagination of J.K. Rowling, and you can write a Harry Potter book. But you go to America, and the very serious generals would explain to you how the Jordan River protects Israel. Of course, they've never seen the Jordan River. They think about, what's the name of your lovely river?
Vltava.
They think about something like that. Of course, in today's weaponry, even that is not that important. But even if you go back a little bit for conventional armies to cross the River Jordan, all you needed was a good donkey and nothing else. But it convinced a lot of Israelis, without the Jordan River, we are exposed. There will be an invasion from Iraq and Jordan. They will destroy us. Thank God we have this little toilet called Jordan River. It will stop the armies coming in. So the second decision was, not to expel. The second was Israel cannot exist without some control over the West Bank. Again, I'm not saying it's the same true about Gaza, but the West Bank looked like an integral. And then came the third question. If we do not expel the people, and we are not giving back the West Bank to anyone, what will happen to the people of the West Bank? So one very liberal minister said, let's give them citizenship. You know, we did the same in Israel. We had 150,000 Palestinians when we created the Jewish state, and eventually, after a military rule, we gave them full citizenship. Let's give citizenship to the people of Nablus, of Halil, of Jerusalem. And of course, he was immediately silenced. He said, are you crazy? There are 1.5 million. There were 1.5 million, 67. There will be 3 or 4 million. You will not have a Jewish state. Because, you know, the idea of Israel of democracy is that democracy is fine as long as there is a Jewish majority. When there's no Jewish majority, there cannot be a democracy. You cannot trust the Arabs to be part of a democracy. So Jewish democracy and Jewish demography goes together. And if you give equal rights to the people of the West Bank and the Gaza Strip and the Palestinians inside Israel, you are in danger of losing your demographic majority. So this was totally ruled out. So the question still remains, what do you do with the people? And this is when the two-state solution came about. The Israelis said, we know what, you are already aware that the Zionist movement is in love with partition. They like to divide. They said, let's do partition in the West Bank as well. Let's divide the West Bank. This was the idea of one of the great strategists of Israel after 1967. His name was Yigal Alon. I don't know if you heard the name. And he had a plan called the Alon Plan, which was the blueprint for all the Israeli policies after 1967. Alon said, let's divide the West Bank into two parts. One part is a part which has to be under direct Israeli rule. And he had a map. He said exactly which part. He said, the Jordan Valley has for always to be Israel. You know why? Because there's this huge river that protects Israel. So we need, but because the river is not so big, we need the whole valley as well just to be on the safe side. So we need the Jordan, by the way, the Jordan Valley is 30% of the West Bank. So when once you take out the Jordan Valley from the West Bank, not much is left of the West Bank. Then they said, another part we want is Jerusalem, the eternal capital of the Jewish people, right? Now, they did a little trick with Jerusalem. They said, Jerusalem is not Jerusalem, it's Greater Jerusalem. Greater Jerusalem is like amoeba. Every year it grows. I don't know why, but most of the maps in my atlas don't move. Well, one map that moves in my atlas is the map of Greater Jerusalem. If you're not careful, Prague would be part of Greater Jerusalem. It grows all the time. All the time the Israelis change the municipal boundaries of Greater Jerusalem. Maybe we are already citizens of Greater Jerusalem, for all we know. And it's now one-third of the West Bank. So we took one-third in the Jordan Valley. We took one-third of the Greater Jerusalem. And then, but that happened a bit later, when the Jewish settlers came, the Israelis invented another area that has to be Israel, and you are familiar with it. This is called the settlement blocks. The settlement blocks are not settlements, really. They are proper cities that Israel built near the border that used to be between the West Bank and Israel. And they said, you know, it's so close to Israel anyway, so let's annex it anyway, right? So now, and they are about 15%. Now, I don't know how you are in mathematics, but if you take the Jordan Valley, the Greater Jerusalem area, the big settlement blocks, and you come to the Palestinians as they did in the Oslo Accord, and they said, we, Israel, the Zionist movement, we are the most generous people on earth. Nobody, even the Czech, are not as generous as we are. We offer you in the rest of the West Bank a state. The Palestinians make clear, not much is left. They said, okay, it's better than nothing, so we'll take it. I mean, like, what do we have? I don't think the Israelis meant the Palestinians to take it. They were surprised when the Palestinians said yes. So they invented a new thing, as you noticed. And that thing is called the myth that there's no one to talk to. Because if Israel was about to implement even its generous offer, it would have run into trouble inside Israel, with ideological movements in Israel, and the whole idea that you're not supposed to give the Palestinian a state, you're supposed to give them kind of an autonomy, maybe, in the areas which Israel is not interested in, right? And I think the fact that the Palestinian leadership, the Palestinians under occupation, in the second intifada, in second uprising, felt that, even without a calculator, they felt that this is not worth the paper it's written on as a solution, as the end of the conflict, as a settlement for the problem. And they rose against this idea in the second intifada. The Israelis said, okay, now there's another problem. This is today. We are taking out from the future Palestinian state the Jordan Valley, the greater Jerusalem area, the big settlement blocks, but we have to punish you for the second intifada and the way you behaved since the second intifada. So we are adding some additional blocks to the settlement blocks. The Israelis have a word for this. It's called the natural growth of the settlement. The natural growth is like the ameba of greater Jerusalem area. It grows all the time. Whether there is a natural growth or not, it doesn't matter. In other words, what I'm trying to say here is that in 1967, Israel created a formula that for the outside world and for good people around the world looked reasonable, and I can understand it. And that was called the two-state solution. So on the face of it, the idea that Israel withdraws from the West Bank and from the Gaza Strip does not allow any Jew to settle there and allows the Palestinian to develop a Palestinian statehood, even if you are not a great believer in such concept, you could say, you know what, that's a beginning. That's a beginning, and you can see why quite a lot of people in the Arab world, people in the Palestinian communities, definitely people who lived under occupation, but, you know, some great people, like people, conscientious people, one of them was here, I understand, maybe in this room, Norman Finkelstein and Noam Chomsky, why so many people were mesmerized by this idea? Because on the face of it, they said, it's a positive step forward. I think what they ignored is that words do not create reality. Bulldozers do. Armies do. Words do not create reality. And if you study Zionism as well as I did, and you understand that the two-state solution from a Zionist perspective is not a two-state solution. It's a solution for the problem they created themselves in 1967. They want the territories without the people. They want the territories without the people, but they don't want to appear as a criminal state while doing it. So you create a peace process that doesn't go anywhere. So you say, we are thinking about this two-state solution, but the facts on the ground make it impossible. So I think it's however you think about the two-state solution, and I know we have in the movement of solidarity with the Palestinians in Israel, in Palestine, we have a debate. It's a legitimate debate whether we should continue to support the two-state solution, whether we should try something new and support the one-state solution. I think that's a legitimate debate, and I think it should continue. I think it's an important debate. But before you do the debate, what I don't like to hear, and that's my disagreement with my good friend Noam Chomsky, and that's why we wrote a book together about it, because I disagree with him, don't say that there is an Israeli position that supports the two-state solution. I think that's not true. You can be for a two-state solution, but you have to be aware that the stronger party in this conflict, the people who have the keys to the car, do not believe in a two-state solution. And I'm not talking about the right wing in Israel. I'm talking about the center and the left. What they believe is a two-state will never satisfy even the most moderate, submissive Palestinian. And that's important to understand. From an Israeli perspective, the Oslo Accord was not meant to create a two-state solution. It was meant to get an international recognition for the arrangement that they have found in 1967 for how to have the territories without having the people. They divided the West Bank into two parts. They gave the Palestinians, as always, the smaller part. They said in the smaller part, you can have a flag, you can have a president, you can even call it a state if you know, we don't mind. You can call it a state, but we have the right to enter that state with our army to arrest people whenever we want. We can take part of that state and annex it if we find it necessary. We control all the water resources of this state. We collect the taxes for this state. I checked in all the books in the world. Never did I find a sovereign state that someone else has collected taxes for them. Where?
Nicaragua.
Really? Yeah, well, I'm not surprised. Thank you. that's not a very inspiring example. You know, the whole idea is how you, the Palestinians, can help us to implement our idea. Now, maybe, and I can understand it, if you live in a certain part of occupied the West Bank, you say it's better like that than it was under direct occupation. I'm not sure, but I'm not the one to say this. I'm living under Israeli occupation. But, and all these are, again, legitimate views. What I'm saying is, it's time to understand that the, and with this I would end before I will just say a few words of how we move forward. But it's time to understand that whatever you call Israel, whether you're talking about the government of Israel, whether you talk about the Israeli parliament, whether you talk about the Israeli academia, whether you talk about the Israeli media, I think it's very important to understand. There is no voice inside Israel that really believes in a two-state solution. They believe in the continuation of the brilliant solution they found in 1967, by which the Palestinians are closed in small areas, they control the rest, and if the world is willing to call it a solution, that would be wonderful. If the world is not willing to call it a solution, let's talk about the peace process that will call it a solution, but nothing is going to change fundamentally. Israel is going to be present on the Jordan River, it was going to be present on Hebron, in Hebron, it will be present in the ever-growing Greater Jerusalem area, it will be present in the Jordan Valley, and if you look at the map with a magnifying glass, you will find the space where the Palestinians can live under this solution. And this is not a right-wing perception. This is a consensual Israeli perception. The present government of Israel has is made of political parties that all, in one way or another, subscribe to this idea. Maybe one or two voices in the parliament do not, but the government as a whole subscribes, and the government represents 90% of the Jewish people. Now, this is the analysis. You may share this analysis, you may not. What is the prognosis? And I have another 5 minutes.
10 minutes.
No, I don't know. I'm a historian. My prognoses are short. My analyses are very long. Other people should do the prognosis. There are three conclusions, if you accept my analysis. Of course, I have to warn you, not everybody accepts my analysis. And when I make these analyses in Israel, I have to go and teach in England. So I want you to be clear about this. But there is, if you accept at least in major part this analysis, there are three major conclusions. One is that without strong outside pressure on Israel, Israeli policies will not change. No peace process like Oslo or whatever is going to replace Oslo is going to bear fruits of any kind. Definitely not two-state solution. Because a peace process is not pressure on Israel. A peace process assumes that both sides want genuinely to find a reconciliation. It's utterly wrong to assume that about the state of Israel. It uses peace processes to perpetuate the occupation. Now, if you want to help Israel to perpetuate the occupation, go to the Israeli embassy. They have these little boxes. You can donate some Czech money. They prefer dollars, I think, but doesn't matter. And you can help them. But supporting the peace process is not supporting the peace process. Supporting the peace process provides Israel immunity to continue with its impunity. That's my first conclusion. And that's why I supported so much the BDS movement, the boycott, divestment, and sanction. I really believe, like in the case of South Africa, you need the international community, the conscience people of the international community, to say to Israel, enough is enough. It's a non-violent means. I don't believe in violence. Don't misunderstand me. It's a non-violent means that sends a message to Israel from the civilized world, which Israel wants very much to belong to. If you continue to do what you do, you cannot be a member of the civilized world. There's a price to be paid if you want to be counted in the civilized world. Now, of course, they can come to Prague and think that the civilized world is behind them. But Prague is not the whole world. And maybe also Prague would one day send its Israel a clear message that Israel is not part of the civilized world. You have a mission here. The second conclusion is that you have to think about a new political solution that would allow Jews and Palestinians to live together in the land of Palestine. Because all these old ideas of two states are not going to work. That doesn't mean that I have a magic formula. You talked about Brit Shalom. They thought about the bi-national state. I like more the idea of a democratic state. I'm not particularly in love with nationalism myself. But it doesn't really matter. I think what matters at this point is not so much what is the solution, but who is legitimate partner in discussing the solution. Are the Palestinian refugees a legitimate partner? If they are, then let us hear us saying that, that they have the right to discuss their return to their homes. And then you have a different kind of discussion. What kind of political outfit would be able to provide equal rights to three groups, the native local Palestinians who were always in Palestine, the Zionist Jews who came, they came as a settler colonialist movement. Now there's already a third generation. I don't think a third generation is not allowed to stay. I think a lot of Palestinians realize it. Even if you are a third generation of, like I am, of a settler colonialist, you are now part of the land. You were born there, your parents were born there. It's ridiculous to think that you can throw them out as well. So this group also has to be integrated. And the group that was expelled, the refugees. You don't have to be a genius to find out the new frame in which people should live together on the basis of equal rights, whether they are locals, refugees, or the third generation. You know what? Even if they came from Prague 2 weeks ago to be part of the State of Israel, they could be integrated. Contrary to all the mythologies that you hear, there is space for everyone. There's plenty of space in Palestine. You can divide the resources between everyone. You just have to have the political will to accept everyone as an equal. If you don't accept everyone as an equal, resources become a problem. Space becomes a problem. But if you accept everyone as an equal, then you can build something else. And the third conclusion, and with this I will end, is that there has to be, and I know it would be very, very painful for the Israelis. Very, very. I'm not eluding myself. But the Israelis would have to go through the same process that the whites in South Africa went through. And it was, believe me, it was painful for the whites in South Africa. You don't need all the Israelis to go through that process. When apartheid fell in South Africa, most of the whites in South Africa were still racist. It's not that every white in South Africa suddenly was anti-apartheid when apartheid fell. I suspect the vast majority of them were still for apartheid. But a small enough number, or a large enough number, began to reread the historical situation. And when you reread the historical situation, and you say, we came here, maybe for good reasons. That's okay, the problem is not our reasons. We came here because we wanted to come here, and we felt that this was our homeland, no problem with that. But there was someone else here. And we expelled the persons who lived here, the people that lived there. And we were not unique in it. White people, when they were pushed out of Europe, pushed the non-white people from wherever they came to. There's nothing new in this. Now, if you want to have reconciliation, you have to start with this point. You have to start with this point. Then you can come to the Palestinians. You can even come to the Arab world. You can come to the Muslim world and say, stop talking about us not being part of the land. We are part of the land. Don't tell Mr. Ahmadinejad to talk that we're not going back to Germany. Okay. But in order to have this kind of conversation with the local people, saying now it's time to explain that we are here and you are here and we are reframing our relationship, you have to accept that you were not here before. Now, I'm a member of the Israeli Academia, a former member of the Israeli Academia. But I must tell you, the amount of money and energy we invested in order to prove that we were always there, you could have built 5 hospitals. You could have built 3 bridges of peace between Israel and Palestine instead of all the money that went. And I will end with the story which is 99.5% true. And because I always add something to the story, because I keep telling it. And every time I add something new. I don't remember what I did, but it's a good story. It tells you exactly how Zionism treated the whole idea of proving that Palestine was always a Jewish state. And really, most of the Israeli Jews believe in it. And that's part of the problem. You know, in 1937, the British, after already 10 years of rule, were very frustrated with ruling Palestine. And they wanted to offer a solution. So they sent an inquiry commission called the Peel Commission. And the Peel Commission was supposed to suggest the first solution to the Palestine problem. And 2 weeks before they came, the most important historian of the Jewish community in Palestine, Ben Sion Dinburg, who was later a minister of education, was invited by the head of the Jewish community, David Ben-Gurion. And he said to him, you know, in 2 weeks' time, the Peel Commission appears. I need for you to prepare, as a historian, the history of the Jewish people since the Roman time in Palestine, so that I can prove to the British committee that the Jews were always present in Palestine, despite the expulsion. So Ben Sion Dinur says, I am an historian, I'm a serious historian, I cannot do it in 2 weeks. It's a lot of periods, it will take me 10 years to complete such a project. So Ben-Gurion said to him, you don't understand, they come in 2 weeks. You say that there was always Jews in Palestine, then you have 10 years to prove it. Okay, thank you. I think I'll end here and take some of your questions. Thank you.
Thank you. So now we have time for questions and debate. So those who want to ask a question or have some remark, please introduce yourself and maybe also say an institution if you are here as a representative of some institution. Please.
My name is Leon Rosenfeld. I'm a private individual. I live in Prague. I live most of my life in Austria, but I'm not back in Prague. I have a question. I must say I educated myself a bit before coming here and watched some of your interviews on YouTube. And the interesting thing was to read the reactions by some of the proponents of the one-state solution. My question is, with whom would you like to share this one state? Because most of the comment that I saw was that you are Haifa is where you come from, is occupied Palestinian territory, and not a single settler would be allowed to live in such a state. The other question, a related question, concerns the democratic and secular nature of such a state. You didn't mention secular, Mr. Barša mentioned secular.
Okay.
You only mentioned democratic. First of all, democracy means different things to different people. And why do you think would such a state, a state as you yourself say, with a Muslim Arab majority, what makes you think that would be democratic? Because according to the public opinion polls, Pew research, and etc., most Muslims in countries, in similar countries, in Egypt, Jordan, when asked, they favor stoning for adultery, they favor cutting of hands for theft, they want people who abandon Islam to be assassinated, mm-hmm. murdered. So what makes you think that such a state would be secular and that it would be democratic, because it would be sustained in an Arab majority?
Mm-hmm.
And if you show me the state in Arab majority that's secular and democratic, I'm not talking about Turkey, which would be an exception, but it's a separate story. But a country similar to Palestine, that is Jordan, Egypt, are they democratic? Are they secular? So what is the model for such a state?
Okay, thank you. Let me start with your first question. I would like very much to create one state with all the Palestinians I know and all the Jews I know. I was born in Haifa. My friends are both Palestinians and Jews. I speak Arabic, I speak Hebrew. I feel at home where Palestinians and Jews feel at home. For me, it's not a theoretical question. I don't study Islam, Judaism, and Christianity to ask myself, as you do, whether these three religions can live together. I know the people. I've known the Palestinians since my very early days as a child. I listened, believe me, it was difficult to listen to you to the end, so please listen to me to the end. It was not very easy, and without any pill, I listened to you. So, these people are the citizens of Haifa. They are my friends from Ramallah, my friends from Gaza, my friends from the Palestinian diaspora, from refugee camps. I would love very much to share the country with them. In fact, I have much more in common with them than with a Jew that would be born tomorrow in Brooklyn, and according to Israel, has the right of Israeli citizenship. I don't know what I have in common with a Jew from Brooklyn. I know exactly what I have in common with my friend Mahmoud from Haifa. We are sons of the same city. We share the same taste in food, in literature. We have the same dreams of an equal society. We have the same dream of a state for all its citizens. So I'm not alone in this. Now, on both sides, there are fanatics. There are Jewish fanatics who don't want to see anyone who is not a Jew, who don't even want to see anyone who is not a Jew like them live in the state. There are fanatic Muslims who don't want to see anyone who is not a Muslim, and not everyone who is not a Muslim like them. That's the only petition I would have liked to see, to put these Jews and Muslims and fanatic Christians in one state and send them to Mars if I could. But the vast majority of the people I know, and I can only judge by the people I know, who are Muslims, Christians, and Jews, are people who are basically, and that's my take on humanity, are good people. I don't care if someone is a Muslim or a Christian or a Jew. I care what they think about me, about life, about sharing life. So in other words, the experience, maybe because I come from Haifa, which is a mixed town, or maybe because I speak Arabic. Most Israeli Jews do not bother to learn Arabic. Or maybe because I was in Tahrir Square and I saw Egyptians fighting for democracy. Maybe because of that I have a different take than you are. I am convinced that there is an equal number of people who want to live in a democratic, equal society in Palestine and Israel as there are in the Czech Republic. And for my last 2 days here, maybe there are more in Israel and Palestine. So I don't buy into this idea. Now, you gave an interpretation of Islam that would have made a lot of fanatic Muslims very happy. But there is 1,300,000,000 Muslims in the world, and they have different takes about Islam. And they have different views of how to interpret Islam. Now, you asked me about the democratic secular state and the model. I know that you like secularism in the Czech Republic. I'm not crazy about secularism. I am much more interested in a dialogical state. I'm interested in a state because that's what we have in the Middle East. You may not like it if you live here, but we like multi-ethnicity. We like different colors. We like a variety of views. We don't like homogenic societies, even if they're secular. And what we want to do is the ability to create a continuing dialogue, which has a clear rules of how you continue the dialogue. Now, the dialogue is not just between secular people who are right and religious people who are wrong. The dialogue is between religious people and secular people, how to live and let live. It's a huge project. It won't be easy to build it. But the whole Middle East, not just Israel and Palestine, the whole Southeast Asia, most of Latin America, quite a lot of North America, and you will find out that also in Europe, would have to find that dialogue. If anybody eludes himself that he can impose secularism on traditional religious people, okay, he can impose religion or traditional views on secular people, they are both wrong. So actually, I'm quite hopeful from what...
It would be a Muslim state.
A Muslim state is a state that works according to the Muslim religion. Now, most of my Muslim friends don't want a Muslim state. Most of my Muslim friends in Palestine want a democratic state. I don't know where you're taking this idea from. I don't know which surveys you're reading, probably the ones published by the Israeli foreign ministry. I can understand. I wouldn't trust everything that they publish. I would be a bit careful. I think
the US.
I wouldn't. Oh, in this case, now I know why you're wrong. Now I know why you're wrong. Okay. Oh, yes, of course it's.
Yeah,
no, it shouldn't be. America shouldn't be disputed. I understand it after 5 minutes here. America should not be disputed. But I dispute America. I dispute America. America is responsible for much of what is wrong in my own country. There is a vast majority of people in Israel and Palestine, you will be surprised, that want to live. They want to live normal life like you do. And there are Muslims, and there are Christians, and there are Jews. And the reason that these people cannot live normally is Zionism, not Islamic fundamentalism, which is a problem, I agree. But the main reason today between the River Jordan and the Mediterranean that I cannot enjoy the life that you have is Zionism. And I want to get rid of it. Ah, I feel much better after I said it. Okay.
Okay.
Representing you myself.
But, thank God, not the army. Okay, yeah.
I'm thankful for having the opportunity to listen your analysis and your inspiring ideas. But I'm interested in a little bit more strategic prognosis.
Okay.
On the future, let's say, on the future of Israel's state, wanting or not, we have been witnessing some global political shift and in the changing the point of gravity in the global politics. How can Israel survive under changing global circumstances if it won't accept the solution that you suggest? And it seems they are
serving strategic interests of superpowers. But they also believe that they have a moral pillar, that the strength comes from their moral right. But because they are morally right, they are also successful. This pillar has almost gone in the civil society, at least in the West. Israel's moral... Is she from the embassy? No. Okay. Moral right... moral pillar has been eroded. So what I'm saying, it's eroded. It has been almost shrunk because people do not accept the Israeli policies as moral policies. And some people even go as far as saying if the policies are immoral, there's maybe a more serious problem with the ideology of the state. Now, of course, even if your ideology as a state is suspect internationally, you can still be supported strategically, because you serve another interest. And I think that you're right. As long as the U.S. stands behind Israel, they don't, even if the moral pillar is gone, they can still survive because of that. I would go even further. I think Israelis were preparing for such an eventuality. That's why they have their own military industry. They have also viability to stay even with less support from the American. And Israelis would tell you, you know, actually, if you look at China, if you look at India as rising powers, or even Russia as rising powers, they would say distinguish between what they would say diplomatically and the military ties that we have with them, or the industrial ties. So we are already preparing for the eventuality of a new power balance in the world. Even if America is weaker, and Russia and India and China would become more important, we are already building strategic ties with these countries. So I think that Israel as a state will continue to exist. The question is, how would the people of Israel, or at least some of the people in Israel, how would the Jewish communities around the world feel with a country that becomes more and more suspect on an ethical and moral basis? That's the question. It doesn't mean that it's not a viable country, that it does not succeed, but what is the quality of life there? If you are being listed together with apartheid South Africa, with Chile's Pinochet, and with another number of states which are not very positive, that means that you have a certain international standing. And I think that is a question that I hope would lead Israelis to change. I agree that in the near future, I cannot see the Israelis subscribing to my ideas. I agree with you. But I should say something on this, because I forgot to say it in my talk. Israel, there is a one-state solution already. Israel is controlling the whole of Palestine. And it rules the life of Palestinians with different means. It rules the life of Palestinians in the West Bank differently than it rules the life of Palestinians in Jerusalem. And it rules the life of Palestinians in Jerusalem differently from the way it rules the life of Palestinians in the Galilee. And it, despite of what the Hamas may think about Gaza, it also rules Gaza in the way it wants to rule Gaza. So it rules Palestine and the Palestinians. So you have a one state, but you have a regime that has to change. And the question is, how do you change a regime? And you don't want to change a regime the way the Americans change regimes, which is by bombing capital cities. You want to change regime by an evolutionary process. And I think that's, for me, the idea of the one state, that slowly you work from below, with pressure from the outside, to make that place where you have now 6 million Jews and 6 million Palestinians all together to have more and more equal rights. You will say to me, you're crazy. How can you dream about such a thing? And I'll take you back to the south of the United States in the 1960s. If you would say to someone that African-Americans in the United States would be have a better life, nobody would have believed you. I will take you to South Africa before the fall of apartheid, to the Soviet Union before the fall of the Soviet Union. I'm an historian. I'm not impressed by a lack of progress of 65 years. It's less than a second in history. I know that activists would like to see change in their lifetime. I'm not obsessed with seeing change in my lifetime. I'm obsessed with doing everything possible that change will come. Whether in my lifetime or not is less important to me.
Okay. Up there. Yeah. Yes.
First of all, thank you very much for a very enlightening speech.
Thank you.
Ed Avok from the Finnish Embassy, though, as a private friend. it's not very often I can see someone from your background, so I was wondering, having taught in university in Haifa, if you could say a few words about the education in Israel and also the university education. To what degree are views such as your own taught?
Right.
How much of a voice do you have?
Yeah.
And also, just a personal point, you say academics yeah. shouldn't be involved in the policy process as much, but with your ideas and communication, you should be.
Thank you very much. I have a short answer and a long answer. The short answer to your first question is I have to teach in England. That's a good answer for your question. But the longer answer is, you see, Israel is very interesting in this respect. The Zionist indoctrination of the Jewish people in Israel is not achieved through coercion. It's not that people are oppressed to think that way. It's a very successful and very impressive way of thinking that is planted in you from very early on. And you really believe in it, not because someone says to you will be punished if you don't believe in it, but you really believe, you are brought up in a way that makes you see the reality only through the pair of glasses that the state has provided for you. And it's very difficult to understand it for people who have come from the outside. And academics, for instance, do not understand that when they have these pair of glasses, their research would fit the ideology, would not challenge the ideology. You know, Noam Chomsky has a brilliant chapter on this in his book, Utopian for the Masters, in which he explains how the relationship between, he talks about America, the United States, but I think it's true about Israel as well. This reciproc complicating relationship between the academia and the powers, the political powers. The political powers give you the resources, the prestige, the job, and you return by giving them scholarly proof to their ideology. And this is a circle which is very difficult to break, because why should you bite the hand that feeds you? Now, the hand that feeds you wants a scientific proof that it's correct. So you provide them. You say them, there was Jewish continuity in Palestine, and you have 10 years of career to prove it. You know, they do it. I think the, I always ask myself, which is the more interesting question? Is the interesting question, I once thought the interesting question is, why such a vast majority of Israeli academics and educators are willing to educate and research in such a loyal way to the ideology? But I think the more interesting question is why people like me liberated from this kind of ideology. Because that's an activist question. If there are 50, 100 people like us, maybe there is a way forward here. And if I look at my own story and the story of my friends who think like me, spending a long time outside of Israel was an important, crucial part of it. You have to get out of this fluid to see what's in it. You can't do it from the inside. Or for instance, having Palestinian friends, see that they are also human beings. Such a simple thing, you know. I live in Israel, in a very affluent part of Israel, with very educated professionals, lawyers, dentists, you know, the people who make money. And I did a kind of a home university in my house. The ignorance of these Israeli Jews about the Palestinians, who live 2 minutes walk, not 2 minutes drive, 2 minutes walk from them, is mind-boggling. It's mind-boggling. The question they asked me about the Palestinians, I'm ashamed to repeat them here. And they live 2 minutes walk from them. And they had no idea that these are other human beings. It's surprising. So you on the one hand you say, once you are out of it, you say, how can you think like that? But when you're inside, the educational system plays a very important role. You know, Israeli education system is segregated up to the higher education. Arabs have their own schools, Jews have their own schools. They meet in the university. There are no private universities, by the way, because Israel was afraid that an Arab university would be a hotbed for Arab nationalism. So they meet in the university. Now, I was teaching in a mixed university. The largest number of Palestinian students is in the University of Haifa, where I taught. But it's still segregated. It's still segregated. In my classroom, which was 50-50, the Jews were sitting on one side, the Palestinians did. I always said to my class, if I want to explain to someone what is the conflict, I will invite you to see you. I will say something nasty to you, and I will say something nasty to you, and we'll have the conflict. This is a segregation that is self-imposed. But if you talk to Palestinians, they don't have this complex. They want to share the land. They want to share the life. It is this Zionist obsession. The Jews, that's why I began my lecture with this. You have to understand this. The Zionist lesson from the very difficult Jewish experience in Europe. I'm never underrating this experience. This was a horrific experience. Jews in Prague, as elsewhere, wanted to assimilate in Europe, wanted to be like the Europeans, and the Europeans reciprocated with the Holocaust. That's a horrific experience. I can understand it. And then, of course, you say, I want a safe place. But you want to continue to live in a ghetto? I never understood this. You run away from a gated community, and you create a gated community in someone else's homeland. Only for a Zionist, this looks like a very logical sentence. Once you're liberated from it, you lose the touch with this kind of thing. So education is important, but I want to explain that this is more than education. I don't like always Michel Foucault, but sometimes the idea of a discourse, his ideas of discourse, are very powerful for explaining Zionism. you know, this idea of Foucault of discourse, that you read the reality in a way that make you think that you made your own decisions about it. But actually, the language makes sure that you can only read it in one way. It's very powerful. I don't know if it's true for every reality, but from Zionism, it works so well.
Thank you. There, up there. Yeah.
Hi.
I can stand up so that I can see you.
That's okay.
My name is Yaroslav, I'm a sociologist at UC Prague, and I have friends in Ramallah, I have a friend in Gaza. I also have Israeli friends with whom I studied and
so do I.
In the United States, and who decided not to return to Israel because it would be, as they said, it's almost impossible for a liberal intellectual to go back to your country and to live there and to look at your face in a mirror every day. They just don't know how to relate to their families, how to relate to their mm-hmm. friends, so they stayed in the United States. Or many of them chose Germany as a paradise for their agenda that is very similar to yours. When it comes to, you mentioned political pressures that could efficiently steer or change the climate where Israel would reconsider itself as a different, more democratic, more inclusive, imagined community. Do you have any specific set of expectations that, for instance, how would you like European Union to act vis-à-vis Israel in order for people like you to, to feel more comfortable with your agenda?
Yes. First of all, I'm happy to report that not everybody who subscribed to my views has left. So there's still people around, and there's a new generation of people who think differently. I think that all of us, including myself, who have left, should go back, and we are trying to go back. We are not suffering as some dissidents really suffer in other countries. So even if the price is high, and what you describe is very familiar to me, the inability to talk to your friends, your family, and even worse things. But it's all bearable. You may find, we all find it difficult, but I think it's a price one can pay. And I think that pressure from the outside, for example, a clear EU position on certain things would help. Because what happens is that if the rest of the society, not the rest, if the vast majority of the society thinks differently than you do, and at best calls you a lunatic, and at worst calls you a traitor, if your views are subscribed to, are supported by a vast majority of people around the world, you don't feel either a lunatic or a dangerous person. And I think that's why it's so important for people like myself to know that there's so many people around the world who share this analysis, who share these positions. And I think a lot of Israelis understand that these positions are now respected. We had a very interesting experience in my house. I brought one of the, my wife actually, brought one of the persons who is quite known in Israel for refusing to serve in the army because of the occupation. Because we have boys who are about to serve and they wanted to hear all the opinions. And one of my boys said to him, the problem is how the rest of the society will treat us if we decide not to. That's a strong pressure. And he said, you should know that if you subscribe to these views and you come to Europe or abroad, you will be welcomed. People would hug you. People will respect you. So don't only think of how your inner society reacts, think about how the international community reacts. Now, what he was referring to was, of course, the civil society that is more and more pro-Palestinian, and more, let's say, more and more pro-justice, not pro-Palestinian, pro-justice, than it was before. But we know that the political elites are not there yet. But I must tell you, about South Africa, it took 21 years from the first act of civil obedience for South Africa, against apartheid. If you remember, there were two brave women in Dublin that worked in a supermarket, and they refused to do the bill for a lady that had a lot of South African products in her trolley. And they didn't do the bill. They said, we don't want to support apartheid South Africa. They were fired. The next day, women all through the chain of the supermarket walked out, and there started the anti-apartheid movement in Europe. But it took 21 years before the first European government was willing to impose sanctions on South Africa. So I think that the EU, you are aiming high, but we have to wait before politicians in the EU would be brave enough to say what they think, anyway, about Palestine. We need more of grassroots activity before it will happen. This will also happen in America. I'm a great believer in the American society. I think there's a serious change in the American community, led, by the way, by Jews, progressive Jews in America, who feel they don't want to be identified with what is being done on their name. Now, I don't want to sound over-optimistic. The situation on the ground is horrific, and is going to be horrific and worse in the next few years. But something else is being built up, outside and inside, that if we are patient and if we are not lose heart, I think the change will come. I believe in it.
How could you explain how in 2005 you predicted what's happening to Gaza today?
I'm not always right, but I had a bad feeling that, as I explained, I thought I had a good analysis of what Israel wants to do with the West Bank, because I've studied it for very long. And I thought, I still think I understand quite well the Israeli strategy towards the West Bank. And I described it in this lecture, so I will not repeat it. I was always confused about the Israeli policy on the Gaza Strip, even before Sharon decided to take out, unilaterally to take out the settlers, even before that. And I was amazed to read very open declaration by Israeli generals that said, even before Sharon made the decision, that unlike the West Bank, where we, they said, as Israel, has a lot of options. We have a lot of options. We can offer autonomy, we can take the autonomy away, we can give them freedoms, we can take freedom. We have leverage. We have leverage. We can play with our control. In fact, the Oslo ABC represents this Israeli idea that you have three options of how to rule the Palestinians, and you can interplay. That they didn't have this option of ABC in Gaza. Gaza is so small, it's so densely populated. They didn't know what to do with it. And the Israeli army more or less said something that I was broadcasting to the world, because I was very worried about it. They said, Gaza is like a maximum security prison, a very dangerous prison. In a dangerous prison, you don't send even the wardens inside. You let the inmates to live their life. The only thing you have to make sure that they don't leave, because they're dangerous, that they don't leave the prison, or that they don't attack you. And if they do, because only inmates are there, there are no wardens, you can do whatever you want with them. You can bomb them from the air, from the sea, from whatever. And the moment the Israeli government decided to take out the Jewish settlers, they took the wardens, the jailers, out of the jail. And they left the jail, which is Gaza, totally exposed. Now, of course, the fact that the Hamas decided to show its resistance through the missiles added ammunition to the Israeli idea of how to do it. But it doesn't really matter. If you remember, Israeli reaction or retaliation to Gaza, well, people forget it because we have so much to remember. It was not always against Qassam missiles. Sometimes it was because there was a demonstration of the Hamas in the West Bank or some sort of other action. This was a mode of action. This is the mode. And I was worried about it because if you know Gaza and you know the density of the population, on the one hand, and you know the military arsenal that Israel is willing to use against it, the only word you can have is genocide for what's going to happen. And that was I was warning about. Now, I didn't know that exactly how 2008 would look like, but it was very clear that they were preparing that. And the last thing that really opened my eyes was that the Israeli army from 2006 to 2008, and this was open knowledge in Israel, prepared for the operation in Gaza. I don't know if you know that, but they have built, I've written about it in my book with Noam Chomsky, they have built a city, a dummy city, an empty city, like in Hollywood. They built a city, which they called Gaza City. And they maneuvered on the city. What would they do if the city is occupied? And in every military exercise, they destroyed the city, as if there were no human beings there. And this really was worrying. This was really worrying. The Israeli perception of Gaza is there's no solution, unlike the West Bank. There's no solution. It's a dangerous place. And we can only use fierce military power. As the Israeli chief of the general staff said, we have to imprint in the Palestinians' psyche in Gaza that it would not be worth the while to resist their prison situation. And that's very worrying. That is really worrying. And if you look at the natural growth prediction for Gaza that was published by OCHA, the United Nations Organization for Human Rights, how many people would live in Gaza in 2020. If in 2020 we will have the same reality that we have today of a ghetto in Gaza, it would be horrific. You know, just the sheer numbers on the space without even Israel doing anything would be horrific.
And our friend is in Gaza right now. And we knew this before, but she's saying from this report also that by 2020 there will be, well, right now there is not enough water. There is no, basically no
exactly water.
They only get water from bottles from, I don't know, UN or who gets through, actually.
Yeah.
But by 2020 it won't be enough for the people who are there. There's not enough humanitarian aid is going through.
The hospitals would not have the infrastructure. The water, it's really a human catastrophe in the making. And I think that our inability as activists to awake the world, one can see how difficult it is when things happening in Syria, in Libya, and other places. You can understand that it's very difficult to attract attention to Gaza when things like happening in Syria, for instance. But I always say that if you find a way, and I'm not sure I have a good way of doing it, but I know what should be done. I don't know how it can be done. When you talk about Palestine, you should always talk in historical context. What happened in one day in Palestine is not terrible compared to what's happening in one day in many other parts of the world. But what happened in Palestine in a historical view in the last 120 years is worse than anything that happened in any other part of the world. And for a media, a modern Western media, to try to convince a journalist that you have to tell your readers, to tell your viewers, your listeners, that they have to understand what happened in the last 120 years and yesterday is very difficult. I don't blame them. It's very difficult. It's much easier to say, yesterday was horrible. There was a massacre yesterday and 500 people died. People can relate to it. But if you want to bring the numbers and to show the catastrophe in the perspective of more than 65 years, it's very difficult for journalists to do it. I understand it. So we have to work on it. We have to explain to people that what they should compare is not today, but the last 15, 60 years, and that nothing has changed and nothing has stopped since the first criminal policies were enacted. And Gaza is a case in point. We don't want 2020 and to say, you know, we told you. That might be too late. Some parts of Palestine, it might be too late. Some parts, it will be all right, but 2020 would be a bad year for Nablus as well, and for the Palestinians in Nazareth as well. if nothing is going to change.
Maybe the very last question. Yes, Shadi.
Hello. My name is Shadi Shana. I'm half Czech, half Palestinian, and coming from several institutions, but here for myself. Would you agree with those people that argue that in present situation it would be wise to dissolve the Palestinian Authority and not to give the Israelis, as you explained here, this benefit of having built up this image that there are equal parties negotiating, that there is a state and president, etc. And perhaps, well, I have a short comment. I'm not so sure about the situation, talking about the perception of Israel in the international community, that it's heading slowly to the same end as the South Africa, for example, was perceived, and that most of the societies in the West are more pro-justice progressively. Of course, I'm coming from the Czech Republic, so we have a reverse trend here, I would say. Maybe it's
no trend.
Not gonna be forever, but the first comment here from the audience also showed that the context is slightly different, that if Palestinians were Buddhists, for example, or you know, Catholics, and not Muslims, which they are not, of course, like not all of them are Muslims, but it would be different. Also, Europe, for example, did not have blood on their hands of white South Africans as they had with Jews. Also, what's going on in Israel and Palestine is not so in your face, so blatant. It gives us, and I'm myself, you know, I have confused. I have some Israeli friends, and you know, they don't, some of them particularly like you too, and they say, you know, it's a bit more complex, it's not black and white. There were these generous offers, 96% of the West Bank, potential to withdraw from Jordan Valley, maybe not when, when the treaty is signed, but you know, there are loopholes, but you know, it's not black and white, and there is this brainwashing from one side. And so when you look at the occupation, I mean, people, and after 9/11, people kind of understand checkpoints, it's for security. So it's not the same situation. So I'm a bit skeptical about that. And my question would be maybe directed towards these generous offers. Is that so, that really this Jordan Valley was always out of the negotiating table, it would be next? Or was there really this offer?
Let's start with the PA, then we move to the two other points, and I'll try and be brief. As I said to you, I'm very careful with words. I mean, it's very easy to dismantle things by words and not take responsibility. On the one hand, I share the analysis that see the PA as something that Israel wants to continue to exist because it is a subcontractor for Israel on security issues, for sure. And it fits well into the model that Israel built, as I described before. On the other hand, it's also the body that provides law and order, employment in some cases. And when you think about getting away with something, you have to think what will happen the next day. Because your assumption is that Israel would then take responsibility, or at least would have to take responsibility because there's no PA. It's one possible scenario. It's not the only one. In other words, I share your analysis that it's an outfit that serves Israel better than it serves the Palestinians. And yet, like with the one state and two states, I want to think further of the alternative, not so much as the destiny. I know where I want to get, but how to get there. How to get there. And I'm not sure my first priority is to dismantle the PA. But it's also a matter of distribution of labor. You know, I don't think it's my job to deal with the PA. It's the Palestinians who will have to decide. And it's, as you will agree with me probably, there is a much larger issue here on the Palestinian side of representation. The issue of representation is something the Palestinians would have to solve. And they have left it open. There's an issue of representation nowadays. There is. And only the Palestinians can solve the issue. I cannot come from the outside and say, I suggest that these and these people will represent you. That's what Zionism did all the time. So it's an issue of representation. And I think when representation would be solved, the also question of agency would be solved, what the Palestinians offer or do not offer. And this was missing, undoubtedly. This was missing. So I think that I would not concentrate on dismantling the PA. I would not shed a tear if it would be gone, but I would hope that this would be part of something more structured rather than focused. You have to be careful. If it's like you want to topple a building, but you want to do it in the right moment, and not to take the first important pillar out and then it collapses and you don't have a building. I also agree with you that it would be far more difficult to end Israeli apartheid than it was to end South African apartheid. I have no illusions. And all the points you made, and I could add to them, show that in the case of Israel, it's far more difficult. The Holocaust, the Jewish lobby in America, the European sense of guilt, these are all elements which were not there in the equation on South Africa. So definitely. But there's something very inspiring in the way that the struggle for South Africa was conducted in Europe and in the West. And I think that's the model we are looking for. Rather than thinking that we can do exactly the same things that were done in South Africa. The cases are similar, but not identical, that's for sure. But it's a good point of analysis. It is a good point of analysis. And it would be far more difficult, I agree. The whole story would be far more difficult. And that's why the arena is also here, not just in Israel and Palestine, and in the United States. But that doesn't mean that it's impossible. It just means you have to be more ingenious and more effective, I agree. And the last point you made about generous offers and so on, you know, even the Americans who participated in the Camp David summit, Mali and Aga Hussein, who wrote, you can find it in Google. These are the two main Americans who participated in the moment that Israel offered its most generous offer. Right, Camp David 2000. They wrote two articles in the New York Review of Books. I recommend you to read that. These are people who are not anti-Israeli. These are official, professional American diplomats. And they talk about the myth of the Israeli generous offer. And they say it was one big charade. In fact, they justify Arafat for not signing the Camp David Accord. 2000. Now, in 2006, we have the Palestine Papers. Very interesting reading. Look at the Palestine. I don't know if you've read it. It's thousands of... But there's a good book that sums for you the nuggets, the good parts. And in 2006, that is what the Israelis offered. They said to the Palestinians, with the help, if you remember, Condoleezza Rice was the Secretary of State. They came to the Palestinians. One Palestinian leader, I won't mention his name, thought it was a reasonable offer, the rest did not. They said, there's no chance for peace. There will never be peace here. What we want as Israelis is to do a unilateral withdrawal. We'll withdraw from those parts of Palestine, of the occupied West Bank, that we are not interested in. Back to the 67 plan, right? And in the rest, we will not declare a peace agreement, but you can do what you want in the rest. You can call it a generous offer if you want. I call it asking the occupied to say thank you 5 times a day for being occupied. It's not a generous offer. It's not a generous offer. This was, I keep telling you, and that's what I was trying to do this in my lecture. The Israeli idea of a two-state solution is that for practical reasons, we cannot control the whole of the West Bank, and we don't want to incorporate the Palestinians who live in the West Bank. So we want to find a solution that does not require us to be responsible for the Palestinians in the West Bank, and yet keeps in our custody, in our sovereignty, most of the West Bank, which is important for us for national and strategic reasons. What is missing, they kept saying since 67, is a Palestinian that would give us the green light for that. We already found the American who would do this. We already found the European who would do this. We found the Russian that would do this. We found everyone. We don't have a Palestinian. And with this, I will end. You know, paradoxically, Israel is, there's no other place in the world where you have such an imbalance of power. The strongest army in the Middle East, one of the strongest armies in the world, and the weakest nation you know nowadays, the Palestinians. You don't have a more imbalance of power in military power, economic power, political power. And despite the fact that Israel is so strong and the Palestinians are so weak, the only people who can really give Israel legitimacy are the Palestinians. And that drives the Israelis mad. It drives them mad. The Americans say you are legitimate. The Europeans say you are legitimate. Every nation from Micronesia to Macronesia says you are legitimate. Do whatever you want, especially if you give us some money. The only people who can really say to the Jews, you're welcome in Palestine, you can be part of the Middle East, are not even the Arab world. That's where the mistake of the Muslim movements around the Arab world, they think that they have the agency. They don't have the agency. The Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt cannot determine whether I can live in Israel or not. But the Palestinians can. They can, unless I will exterminate every one of them. But as long as there's one Palestinian alive, he would need to give me legitimacy. And that drives them mad. They can build 250 nuclear weapons. They can have great technology, and they have. Really, they have. And they have friends in Prague. But they need Abdullah in Nablus to say, Ya Habibi Ibkahun. That's it.
The people here that Ilan is speaking at Philosophical Faculty, Faculty of Arts, tomorrow at the main building, right? 7:30? The room 300.
Mm-hmm.
And I hope you are not the last time speaking in Prague.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Great.